so I will continue with the GI. I think we will finish today with GI. So we will see the next condition, that is the Meckel's diverticulum. So when we say Meckel's diverticulum, it is a remnant. Remnant means remaining of the fetal omphalomesenteric duct that connects the yolk sac with the primitive midgut during fetal period. So this is during the baby is still in the womb of the mother in the fetal period. So what is this? It is actually, when we say Meckel's diverticulum, it is a remaining of the fetal omphalomesenteric duct, that is in the umbilicus, okay, mesenteric duct, which connects the yolk sac with the primitive midgut during fetal period. So normally if we see, the structure is obliterated by the 7 to 8 week of gestation. So usually it will go, okay, obliterated when the baby is about 7 to 8 week of gestation. When the placenta replaces the yolk sac as a source of nutrition for the fetus. So usually this yolk sac will be replaced by the placenta, which will be providing respiration, which will be providing nutrition for the baby. So during that time itself, this structure should obliterate during 7 to 8 week. But if there is failure of obliteration, then it may result in an omphalomesenteric fistula. So this, you know, the structure should obliterate. If it is not obliterating, then it might result to omphalomesenteric fistula. When we say fistula, it is the abnormal connection. Okay, then the diverticulum is usually found within 100 centimeter of the ileocecal valve and averages 1 to 10 centimeter in length. So this diverticulum, okay, that the fistula is usually found within 100 centimeter of the ileocecal valve. So this is the sphincter we have already seen between the small intestine, that is the ileum, and large intestine, that is the cecum. So it is somewhere close by, within 100 centimeter, this diverticulum. Then Meckel's diverticulum is the most common congenital malformation of the GI tract and is present in 1% to 4% of the population. So it is very common congenital anomaly, and then out of the full population we find about, you know, 1 to 4% okay of the population. So next, going on to pathophysiology, although the diverticulum usually is not responsible for symptoms, when ectopic mucosa secretes either gastric acid or pepsin, complications arise. Okay, so usually because of this diverticulum we will not see any kind of symptoms, but if there is ectopic mucosa, okay, which can secrete, so which can lead to more of secretion of gastric acid or pepsin, complications arise. Okay, if there is an ectopic mucosa, extra growth of the mucosa, that can lead to increased gastric secretion or pepsin, complications would arise because of that. It may produce ulceration in the ileum or in the diverticulum, possibly leading to massive hemorrhage, perforation and peritonitis. So if the, you know, if there is in the diverticulum, okay, if this might actually lead to this excess production of the gastric acid or pepsin, can lead to ulceration in the diverticulum, and then it can lead to massive hemorrhage. Because of the ulceration, it can also burst, and it can lead to peritonitis. When it bursts, then it will lead to inflammation of the peritoneum. Then the diverticulum may cause intestinal adhesion, strangulation or intense intersusception, and this may result in intestinal obstruction. So when we say the diverticulum, it can lead to intestinal adhesions, okay, then strangulation. Strangulation is all the intestine turning, you know, like a knot, okay, and then or intersusception, and this may result in intestinal obstruction. So all this can lead to other complications. Then diagnostic history evaluation, as usual, history collection, physical examination, then radiographic study, stool. So when we say specialized, it can be CT, MRI, okay, and then stool examination can be done, then Meckel scan. So to see specifically if there is a Meckel diverticulum, there is a Meckel scan, then radionucleotide scintigraphy. Okay, so radionucleotide, okay, through this they will be sending an isotope and they will be finding out if there is any kind of Meckel diverticulum. Okay, next, coming on to therapeutic management. So the standard treatment is surgical removal of the diverticulum. So they try to remove the diverticulum. When severe hemorrhage increases, there is surgical risk intervention to correct hypovolemic shock, such as blood replacement, IV fluid and oxygen may be necessary. So if there is an hypovolemic shock because of the bleeding, then blood replacement has to be done, IV fluids has to be given, oxygen should be given to the baby or the individual. Then antibiotics may be used preoperatively to control infection. So usually for all the surgery, before the surgery, the patient will be put under antibiotics. Okay, and then you have, if intestinal obstruction has occurred, appropriate preoperative measures are used to reverse electrolyte imbalance and prevent abdominal distension. So all this care has to be taken care. Then coming on to nursing management, first assess the child, check the vital signs. Then the child is often frightened by the appearance of rectal bleeding and should be assured that cause will be determined. So if there is a hemorrhage, okay, rectal bleeding, then reassurance should be given to the baby or the child that the child will be okay. And then if surgery is necessary, the preoperative preparation is done based on child's level of understanding. Okay, and then in the post-operative period, pain control, prevention of respiratory system and early ambulation are indicated. So post-operatively, we have to make sure that we manage the pain and whatever medications has been prescribed by the surgeon or the anesthetist, that has to be continued. Then any kind of respiratory symptoms or infections, distress should be prevented, and early ambulation, making the child to walk early, should be encouraged. Outcome after excision of the diverticulum, full recovery occurs. So after this diverticulum has been operated and taken off, the child will not have any kind of abnormality. The child will recover very fast. Then coming on to ulcerative colitis, next condition. So in that Meckel's diverticulum, we have seen that it is a remnant, the left remaining part of the fetal omphalomesenteric duct, okay, which connects the yolk sac. So usually by 7 to 8 week of gestation, it will disappear. But still, if it is remaining, then it is called as Meckel's diverticulum. Okay, so it is about 1 to 10 centimeter in length, and it is somewhere found within 100 centimeter of ileocecal valve. Definition we have seen, then we have seen, you can see the diagram there, pathophysiology, diagnostic evaluation, therapeutic and nursing management, and the outcome or the prognosis. Next we will go to ulcerative colitis. So when we say ulcerative colitis, it is a chronic inflammatory disease of the large intestine. Then when you see causes, it is unknown. So ulcerative colitis, again in medical surgical you would have studied, okay, it is a chronic inflammatory disease of the large intestine, and then causes is unknown, okay, and then infection, because of any infection the baby can develop ulcerative colitis, or because of any allergy, genetic factors. When we talk about clinical manifestation, frequent small stools with mucus, blood and pus will be present, abdominal cramp will be there, anorexia, lack of appetite, weight loss, anemia, abdominal distension, tenderness, pain on touch, vitamin deficiencies will be found. So when we talk about diagnostic evaluation, it is history collection, physical examination. History, you can ask them since when they are having these complaints, what are the other associated, any GI disturbances are there. Then physical examination, like we can check the weight. If we see like the child has got weight loss, you know, and then to check the abdominal distension, palpate and see for tenderness. Then stool examination, again we will get to know if there is blood, occult blood, okay, blood in the stool or pus or mucus. And then barium enema can be given and it can be detected, proctoscopy, visualization of the rectum, sigmoidoscopy, that is the visualization of sigmoid, and then with mucosal biopsy. So biopsy can be taken and then it can be sent to find out the, you know, if there is inflammation of the colon. And then management, mainly the child will be put under steroid therapy, immunosuppressive, blood transfusion, because the child is having bleeding, okay, and then diet control has to be done. So talking about the surgical management, surgical removal of the colon can be done, or permanent ileostomy, opening in the ileum can be done. So nursing management, again checking the vital signs, encourage the child and parents to express feelings, provide rest to the baby, encourage play, appropriate to age. So for every pediatric condition you have to write this, very very important. We have also dealt with the importance of play, right? So we should not avoid or ignore play because it has its vital functions in the child, irrespective of their age. Every child, you know, if it not contraindicated, play has to be encouraged. And for all children, you know, play is a must thing. So we have to involve them according to the age, see which kind of play can be provided and necessary items can be provided. So encourage exercise and relaxation technique for adolescent, then provide high calorie protein rich diet because they are growing and for home dealing. Vitamin and mineral supplements should be given because they do have vitamin deficiency. Skin care mainly at perineal area, check weight regularly. So these are all the various nursing management to be carried out for a child with ulcerative colitis. Next we will carry on with worm infestations. So when we say worm infestation, they are very common health problems in children, and then it is caused by improper disposal of human excreta. So if the stool or excreta is not properly disposed, then the child is again prone to develop worm infestation. So the common helminths found in human are roundworms, hookworm, pinworm or threadworm or tapeworm. Okay, so these are the four very common which we will be dealing, that is a roundworm, pinworm or threadworm, hookworm or tapeworm. So you can see there are different diagrams that is given in your book. Okay, first we will go to roundworm, which is also ascariasis. So this one is the most common and widespread human infection. Okay, then when we say the causative factor, it is the Ascaris lumbricoides, okay, host. So man is the reservoir of infection. Host means where this worms develop. So mainly it is in the man. It is more infected among preschool age children, and then infective material, feces containing eggs. So if the excreta, somebody has passed the motion, okay, in that it will be found. If the child is already infected, if that particular person has passed the excreta, or somewhere the child goes and plays in the mud or touches the feces, okay, through which it can enter, or through the soil it can enter into the child. Okay, so feces containing eggs. Incubation period, it takes 60 to 70 days after infection for the development of adult worm and excretion of eggs. So and after entering, it takes about 60 to 70, that is 3 months plus 10 days, right, for the development for the adult worms. It starts developing and it also starts excreting the eggs. So modes of transmission, few oral route by ingestion of infected eggs with food. If it is found in the infected food, when the child consumes, then the child is prone to develop, you know, worm infestation, or soil or drink or by contaminated hands and fingers. So that's why hand hygiene is very, very important for children when they go play outside and come. Now it is encouraged for everybody, but we have to be very careful in teaching the child, because sometimes the child will be playing and without mother's notice it will come and touch the food and start eating. So that food taken by others can again lead to complications. Okay, so clinical manifestation, you will see that the child will have general weakness, weight loss will be there, anemia will be there, nausea, loss of appetite, growth failure, pain in abdomen, vitamin deficiency, and then worm in stool or vomit. So when the child vomits, okay, or when the child defecates, you can see the worms. Okay, so treatment, albendazole or mebendazole 2 daily for 3 days, piperazine citrate. Okay, so these are the drug of choice, albendazole or mebendazole 2 daily for 3 days, piperazine citrate. So prevention, how do we prevent? Sanitary disposal, proper disposal of the human excreta should be done. Reduction of fecal contamination of soil. Provide safe drinking water, safe food, hand hygiene, environmental hygiene, proper disposable of the excreta, using toilets and flushing it. Okay, teach children about hand washing before eating and after defecation. Avoid open field defecation. Avoid eating vegetable without cleaning. Avoid pica and playing on contaminated soil. Pica is taking sand and eating, okay, or chalk, you know, the coal. Okay, all this has to be avoided. So these are the measurements that we have to take in order to prevent the round worm infection or the ascariasis. So next topic we will see in the next video, which will be about pinworm and we will finish the other worm infestation.